Okay, we are back. I'm very happy to have on the Goldstein on Gelt show Kirk Sorensen, who's the founder of Flibe Energy. He was previously at NASA, and he does fascinating work in the world of nuclear technology, especially with thorium. Kirk, a real pleasure to have you.
Thanks very much, Doug. I'm glad to be here.
So you're known as a bit of a radical thinker, not because of who you are, but the topic that you're kind of pushing. Could you tell us why thorium is a good idea?
Well, I think thorium is a great idea because thorium is Earth's richest energy resource. We have about 3 or 4 times more thorium in the Earth than uranium, and almost all of that thorium can be converted to useful energy in the proper type of nuclear reactor. And this makes thorium the greatest energy resource that can be found anywhere on the planet. It's common, it's abundant, it's ubiquitous, it's found in every country in the world, and sufficient amounts exist to power the human race for hundreds of thousands of years.
All right, as long as we're around that long. Currently, the cheap fuel that people seem to be using is natural gas. Given that that's all set up now, does it really pay to be looking for something that's A, nuclear and frightens everyone, and B, would require us to do some radical changes in the overall systems?
Yeah, I think it does make sense to look at because nuclear technology can be made to be very safe, and that's based on the technologies that we would hope to use for this thorium reactor. They're passively safe. They shut down on their own, and they don't operate at high pressures, and they don't release radionuclides to the environment. They also make products other than electricity, including important medicines for radiotherapy. So there's a number of reasons to be looking at this technology, not just for electricity.
Okay, one of the complaints or fears that a lot of people have with any sort of nuclear power is that it'll eventually convert into some sort of weapon. What's the story there?
Well, the way thorium is used to make energy is it is exposed to neutrons and it's converted into what's called a fissile fuel, uranium-233. And in this process, uranium-233 is always contaminated with another isotope of uranium called uranium-232. And this really makes uranium-233 a very, very unattractive weapon or a weapons-grade material as far as – and this is because uranium-232 emits strong radioactive emissions that make it very unsuitable for this. We have in the course of the history of nuclear energy, we have turned other fissile materials into materials for weapons like plutonium-239 and uranium-235. But uranium-233 nor thorium has ever been used in any of the 70,000 operational nuclear weapons in the world. And there's a good reason for that. So I believe it offers the safest choice from a non-proliferation perspective as far as how to go forward with peaceful nuclear energy that minimizes the threat of proliferation.
What about the risks of things that we've seen recently, like in Japan and a few years ago, of course, there was Chernobyl? Why would we not worry about that for building new nuclear power plants?
That's a great question. And the fundamental reason why these kind of thorium molten salt reactors are so different than what we saw at Fukushima is they have the ability to passively cool themselves. What happened at Fukushima is cooling water was lost. The circulation of cooling water was lost after the tsunami hit the reactor. And what that led to was a situation where the nuclear fuel melted down and released radionuclides to the environment. The fuel that's used in these thorium molten salt reactors is in a different chemical form that binds those radionuclides into the fuel and prevents them from being released into the environment. Furthermore, it doesn't require the active cooling that the kind of nuclear fuel we use today requires. And so it offers tremendous possibilities for safety as far as being able to design the reactor in a way where it doesn't require active cooling. It also doesn't operate at high pressure like our existing reactors. That high pressure is a term that wants to drive radiation into the environment. And by operating at low pressure, there is no what we would call driving force in the reactor to mobilize radiation out into the environment.
So what would you say is the biggest risk of setting up thorium reactors?
Well, I think right now the biggest risk is that we need to advance the technology and the development perspective to the point where we're ready to build large reactors that can operate for extended periods of time. The technology, while it was demonstrated in the 50s and 60s, has lain dormant for nearly 40 years. And we really need to be energizing a new generation of engineers with hands-on experience in how to utilize the materials, the processing techniques, and the operations of these new style of reactors, because they are in every way completely different than the kind of reactors we have today. They use a different fuel. They use a different power conversion system. They have an entirely different approach to the management and the protection of materials.
We're talking with Kirk Sorensen, a former NASA engineer, and he is now the founder of a company called Flibe Energy. He's been explaining to us the concept of getting energy from thorium as perhaps one of the greatest sources on Earth that would supply us for, as he said, hundreds of thousands of years. Kirk, we've discussed the science a little bit. Tell me now about the money side of it. Is this a good investment?
Well, I think there is a very attractive investment case to be made for this technology, and the reason why in the near term is because of the important medicines that this technology can generate. Radioisotopes that have application both in diagnostic procedures and in fighting cancer. And when we at Flibe Energy believe that this will be the near-term revenue path for the early reactor experiments that we need to build in order to demonstrate and advance the technology.
Sorry, so just while to clarify, you need to have an energy reactor in order to get enough of the isotope to do the medicine?
We need to have a reactor that is actively undergoing a fission reaction. Whether or not we convert that thermal energy into electricity or not, in the early stages, isn't really an important part of our program. What we're looking at is advancing the technology and simultaneously making these important medicines that are commonly used around the world. About 30 million procedures a year take place that use a particularly important radio medicine called molybdenum-99. And it's one of the things that will be made in these reactors during operation.
Okay, so you're saying you're sort of going at this backwards, which is you've got a great way to help people with their health care, and that will create so much income that you will then be able to say, and by the way, the benefit is we have 100,000 years worth of energy?
Well, we project that the revenues from the medical radioisotopes will help us to grow and to develop the larger reactors that will be needed to generate the electricity that the world needs.
Okay, it sounds a little bit like, I mean, I don't want to say it's a long shot, but it sounds like a complicated way to get in, given the fact that there are so many biotechnology companies trying to come up with a new medicine or a new idea that fail. And if it sounds to me like your core idea is the energy production, not that I want to in any way belittle the healthcare benefits, but why wouldn't there be people or energy companies, for example, that would really grab hold of this if it's so potentially economically profitable?
Well, we hope they will. It's just that with the type of reactors we have today, they also make these radio medicines. It's just that they're not in a form that can be extracted from the reactor. Because they have short half-lives and they decay very quickly, that is what limits them from using the kind of technology we have today in order to generate these medicines. What is unique about our design is that we can generate medicine and potentially electrical energy simultaneously. And this medical market for this radio medicine is well established. Like I said, it's a multi-billion dollar existing world market for this material. So we're not creating a new space here. What we are is creating what we think is a very low cost and potentially reliable source of these materials.
Okay, so let's compare this to some of the other cleaner technologies. In other words, I'm understanding from you that thorium is actually pretty clean in terms of the environment. But how does it compare to something like solar or wind?
Well, it's very different than solar or wind in that it is a reliable energy source. It's an energy source that we can count on. And it's also a dense energy source, unlike solar and wind. We don't have to chew up large areas of land, which, frankly, I don't think is very green. We're having a lot of controversy in the United States about legal killing of birds by windmills. I don't think that's terribly green either. So having a reliable and dense energy source is an essential thing. Just a few weeks ago, we had a terrible cold snap here in the United States, and it was reliable and dense energy sources like nuclear, like coal, gas, hydro, that were carrying the day. And I remarked to my wife, I'd hate to be running a industrial civilization on wind and solar right now.
Within the next, let's say, couple of years or 5 to 10 years, what would be the cost of per unit of energy with a thorium reactor compared to either natural gas, which I think today is one of the cheaper and fairly reliable ones, or we could look at it in terms of solar or wind?
Well, we don't have the numbers for that estimate yet because we are still in the preliminary design phase for the reactor. But we anticipate that as we progress the design, that those costs are going to be very competitive with natural gas, and also that there is the potential for an augmented revenue stream, not just electricity like we have in our reactors today, but also medicines, other important isotopes that could be used for power generation, desalinated water, high temperature heat for process heat for industrial processes. So it's a veritable cornucopia of products that potentially could come out of this reactor, of which electricity is merely one. Mm-hmm. And we believe that will continue to improve the economic prospects for developing and deploying these reactors in the future.
So from an investor standpoint, who are the big players in the field today?
Well, the big players in the United States are obviously incumbents like Westinghouse, General Electric, Babcock and Wilcox. And then there are a host of newer players in what's called the small modular reactor space, companies like NuScale, that have been able to win contracts from the United States government, cost-matching contracts. All of these companies that are putting forward essentially various sizes of this same light water reactor technology, you know, reactor based on solid uranium fuel and high-pressure water. And although it is a very developed and mature technology, which is its fundamental advantage, it locks in the limitations of today's technology, the need for continuous cooling, the inaccessibility of valuable products inside the reactor like these medical radioisotopes, and also a relatively low operating temperature. Reactors of this style don't operate at a high enough temperature to, for instance, use air cooling or gas turbine power conversion or to run desalination plants with their waste heat. So this new technology, although it needs development, offers a great deal of potential and as I mentioned, new and enhanced revenue streams.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So you listed a few companies. Just tell us in the last minute, what does your company, Flibe Energy, do?
Well, we were formed in order to go and pursue this opportunity of these molten salt reactors based on the thorium fuel cycle. And although it is a long-term goal, we have been telling the story across the world and also attracting interest from various parties that is enabling us to continue with the design and assessment of these reactor concepts, again, at a low level, a feasibility level right now. But if those results are positive, we will expand into a larger scope and a larger evaluation.
All right. Well, certainly good luck with that. So tell us, Kirk, in the last few seconds, how can people follow your work?
Well, thank you for the opportunity. Our website is flibe-energy.com, Flibe, F-L-I-B-E, and that is a good source of resources on this, links to presentations I've given, papers and documents and so forth. And they can also follow us on our Facebook page, links, and our Twitter account, which are all found there at flibe-energy.com.
All right, and we will put a link to that at the show notes of GoldsteinOnGelt.com. Kirk Sorensen, thanks so much for your time.
Thank you. Appreciate the opportunity to be here.
You've been listening to the Goldstein on Gelt show with money maven Doug Goldstein. Doug's weekly radio show is heard around the world, but if you miss it, you can download the podcast at www.GoldsteinOnGelt.com. The Goldstein on Gelt show gives you up-to-date financial ideas so you can get on the path to financial freedom. If you'd like your questions answered on the air or off, send Doug an email to doug@profile-financial.com. It's your money for your future, so join Doug every week to build your wealth on the Goldstein on Gelt show.